I said in the previous session that it was so astonishing to me that science, which did require experimental evidence, did deal with tools that had no experimental evidence. I want to really make you feel a little more secure about that you do understand just what I'm saying when I say that. As for instance, when I was taught geometry, and I'm sure you were, the teacher went to the board and she made a little square, and she said, "That's a square." And she said, "It is an area bound by a closed line of four equal length edges and four equal angles." And all the geometries she gave me were always areas that were bound by a closed line of so many edges and so forth. There were areas that were bound, and the geometry was something inside that line that was bound there. She didn't say anything about the other side of the line because it was on a plane that seemingly went to infinity. And as much as it went to infinity, there's nothing she could do about that. The finite was always on one side of a line. It was a completely biased affair. Now, one of the fascinating things about the Greek geometry was the way they started playing the game, where they said they had straight edge, scribe, and dividers, and that's all they could have, and whatever they did had to be proven from the already demonstrated. So if you opened the dividers for a given length, you had to prove things in terms of that length. And so when I see that they left out was the surface in which they're going to scribe, they forgot to say it. That's one of the great differences that came along with Einstein, a man, Percival Bridgman at Harvard, who was a great natural history, natural science professor, philosophy of science, history of, and then natural science. He was the one who developed the law going down towards absolute zero and extraordinary pressures and so forth. And Percival Bridgman invented a name called operational procedures. He said, how did it happen that Einstein surprised all the sciences? And he said, because he introduced operational procedures. What he did is to bring in all the circumstances of the experience. And I'll just give fairly quickly about Einstein, how he developed relativity and his concepts about time. He lets us all know how fascinated he was with geometry, all right. And he liked geometry because you learn ways you could prove things yourself. That's a very satisfactory experience. But Einstein, you may remember, not only taught school and so forth, but he also was an examiner in the Swiss Patent Office. And if you were, I've taken out many patents, and I'll tell you one of the things about taking out a patent. You make a claim of having an invention, but you also state the circumstances of your times in the view of which this is a surprise and an invention. And so Einstein, as a reviewer of patent applications in Switzerland, would unquestionably the most prominent of all inventions in Switzerland were timekeeping pieces, watches, clocks, chronometers. And so he would read preamble after preamble about timekeeping, finding all of them found there were none of them accurate. And each one of you trying to get a little bit more accurate device. This made Einstein, I'm sure, feel very much about Newton's working assumption, really, of a quality of time that permeated all universe uniformly. And I think he questioned very much about that. I just wanted to bring this. So yes. Einstein's own observation and from an operational procedure viewpoint, which is a name that Bridgman gave to bringing all the circumstances, would make it, I'll just give you, this is an example of my own invention, but it was one that, as far as I knew, was satisfactory to Einstein, where I have a man who's in a train, railroad train, going due west, and leans out the window and drops a flaming apple. And he has a sextant, so he can measure the angles, and he has a watch, he has a man beside him helping him keep track of what it is he observes. And he sees this thing seemingly sort of shooting eastward, he's going westward and gradually going down the track. and he's able to take the full angle of motion, width of the pattern, and the times involved. I have another man who is standing way to the north of the track when this happened, and he sees that flaming apple come out of the window. See, he sees the line going westward and then down to the track. And he has his sextant. He measures the angle of the, all involved and so forth. It takes time plotting. There's another man standing way up the track to the western, and he sees this light simply stays sort of fixed and going down. And he makes measurement, and he makes very faithful measurements. Then there's another man who happened to be standing. There was a train was going over a trestle when this happened, so he's down on below, and he makes his observations. They all come out differently. They were all, so this is where you get into matter of the necessity of bringing in all the circumstances. So I'm bringing in the fact that the teacher didn't say anything about this being on the blackboard. She is making this so-called abstraction, saying this goes to infinity. I remember first time the teacher drew a straight line, and she said the line goes on to infinity, and I asked her if she had been there. She said no. I said, where does the other end of the line go? She said, that's going to infinity. I said, which way is infinity? So, anyway, she was always having infinity around there, and excuse her from a great deal of the operational procedure stating what else is there. So I'm now going to point out that I often said to students with me, I'd like you to draw me a triangle, and say, where should I draw? And I say, well, we're outdoors, you're drawing the ground. So they get a stick and scratch a triangle, and I say, you made four triangles. They say, no, I've just made one. So I have to prove that they've drawn four triangles. And I say, you do this on the earth, see? And if we have the earth, and I'm just going to make a equator. This is a equator going around. The North Pole is here. And when we draw, that's a closed line. I've drawn it on the earth. And it divides the earth into two areas, doesn't it? The southern and northern hemisphere, everybody knows that. If I draw the line a little further north, what you call 40 degrees north latitude, it divides the earth into a large southern and a small northern, right? I get way up to the North Pole and I draw a little bit of a ring around here. I divide the whole earth into two areas, one enormous southern and a very tiny little northern, right? So instead of drawing a circle up here at the North Pole, I'm going to draw a triangle. And I've divided the whole earth's surface into two areas. And each one of the areas is bound by a closed line of three edges and three angles, which is the definition of a triangle. And so that I said to the boy, you've drawn an enormous triangle here and a little triangle. He said, I didn't mean to draw the big triangle. I said, the trouble is you have, you see. And he said, you must be wrong, because I've been taught that the sums of the angles of a triangle is always 180 degrees. I said, they never are. He said, they taught me school's 180. I said, all right, I've got to prove to you that isn't correct. So I'm going to take the earth again. Here's the equator of our earth. And the equator is called a great circle. It's a line formed on the surface of the sphere by a plane going through the center of the sphere. Right. So I'm going to have the axis of the earth, the North Pole here, and going down South Pole, and we have then what we call latitude, we have the longitudes. The longitudes are great circles also coming through the North Pole. I'm going to go to the North Pole and take a meridian of longitude, and I'm going to go down to the equator. And this impinges on the equator at 90 degrees because the axis is perpendicular to the plane of the equator. And this goes through that axis. So at the equator, I leave the meridian and go on along the equator like this. I go one quarter way around the earth. And then I take a meridian back to the North Pole again. And here's so I leave the equator at 90 degrees because meridians impinge at 90 degrees. Because I went a quarter way around the earth, this up here has to be 90 degrees. That's right?
Yes.
90, 90, 90. It's 270. Is are very real triangles on our real Earth. Fairly typical of triangles. If I bisect the edges here and interconnect with another great circle, I get another smaller triangle. The corners will be about 63 degrees each. If I make another triangle smaller than that in here, it gets down 60 degrees in some minutes, and it keeps approaching 60, but never gets down to 60. So this is what we call this spherical excess, but the point is it never gets quite to 60. They never get it right down to 180. There'll always be something other than 180.
Yes.
So now we realize that is so. I can then come back to where we have the Earth and the triangle little boy Dew on it. So here's his Earth, and here's he's drawing this little triangle here. And he said, well, then this means that this angle out here, if this is 60 plus, and this is 60 plus, and 60 plus, this must be 300 degrees here. So we have a big triangle with approximately 300 degrees each, or 900 degrees. It's a big triangle. 60, 60, 60. But the point is, man has been doing all these little things and made himself absolutely innocent of the big things he was inadvertently doing. So, and again, the ecological and so forth, we throw this little thing over, realizing what it really is building into in the enormous problems of our Earth today, because things are not going to infinity at all, as we used to think they did, but coming around and hitting us in the back of the head. Now, I said four triangles. What do you want to say?
Just the point is that what I get out of what you're saying so far is that you're talking about real experience here rather than some concept that can't be done experientially. Experientially, we live on a globe. So that's what you're telling me, that you make triangles on globes, this is what comes out of them. They don't go to infinity, they come around and hit you in the back of the head.
Well, I draw that here, and I've done it on a blackboard, haven't I?
Yes.
Right? The blackboard goes around here, doesn't it? I've divided the whole blackboard into two areas. All the rest of the blackboard and yes. This part of here.
Yes.
It was just easier to talk about there.
Yes.
All. Now, I find then, this is typical, and I said you cannot ask people to demonstrate two-dimensionality or a plane that is non-experimentally evident. And that's exactly what they assume. I want to make it clear that science has been making some axiomatic assumptions that are absolutely invalid in the terms of really good modern science, such as the Einsteinian. Okay?
Yes.
Now that I've come to that much, then the boys, I said he made four triangles, and he said, no, he thought only one, so we've shown he did two, all right. But we've drawn this on a sphere, and every polyhedron, anything that you can draw on that is a something, is going to be some regular, irregular kind of polyhedron.
Yes.
And it's going to have insideness and outsideness. And this is sphere, so it's concave in the outside and convex in the outside, concave in the inside. And concave and convex are not the same. And energy, radiation, pinging on the concave is concentrated, on the convex it is distributed. Fundamentally different than universe. And physics, the physical universe employs this principle a very great deal. So he's drawn a big and a little convex, and a big and a little concave.
Oh, yes.
You can't make one without the other. So it doesn't matter just the surface, but the inside and outside also are involved in anything you do, ever. So what we're going to be dealing today is then going to be experiential phenomena. We want to use the word mathematics, but absolute experiential mathematics, no axioms whatsoever. There's nothing self-evident. It must actually be all the reality, nothing but the reality. I'm going to play part of reality and say I'm going to have a universe where there is only gravity. So I'm going to have now, that's enough about
Bucky,
that.
Bucky,
yes.
What about the 300 degree outside angles? Is that always 300 degrees, the outside angles of the triangle?
We have a convention of a circle as saying, we say we divide it 360 degrees, you could divide it into 1,000 or any other number you like.
Yes, I meant here, the 300 degree angles, is it always 300 degrees?
No.
No, that was just a figure.
It's just a complementary, whatever this is on this side.
Got it.
But the little one and the big one will always come add up to 360, right?
Fine, got it, yes.
Now, I'm going to, Jamie, like to have those balls. And I have these two forms that I've shown these in so many audiences, and should be some people in this audience have seen me do it before. And if you have seen me do it before, I'd like you not to tell anybody next to you what it is all about. But I use these as really a very important kind of demonstration, because I have confronted I have spoken to a large congress of mathematicians, and I confronted them with these, and they asked if somebody would come up and put them together in a way that we all would agree was the way. There's a the way. And I had volunteers, and they looked them over, and they see these quadrangles, they try those, and doesn't seem to be very impressive. They try these triangles, and they got these. Try these out, they match that way, and then they try, making a raft of them, just like this, and they try putting them end to end like that. Nothing seemed to be very thee about it. So they've exhausted all the possible matchings that you can get. So then I explained a phenomenon called precession. And we find that the word precession means the effect of bodies in motion on other bodies in motion. And the effect, for instance, are here's gravity operating between the sun and the earth. And the precession effect, they're both in motion, of the sun on the earth, is precession, makes the earth go in orbit at 90 degrees to the pull of the, towards the
other. I didn't get that.
Instead of, there's the gravitational pull operating.
Yes.
And the effect of the precession is to make the earth go in orbit around the sun. It acts like a string on a weight. Gravity acts that way, but they're in motion, and so the motion brings about a 90 degree motion and not a falling in motion.
I see.
Right?
Yes.
This is
Bucky, that's because both of the bodies are in motion, both the sun and the earth. Is that correct?
Yep. In fact, the whole universe is all in motion, so the inner effects are all precessional. Now, I just want to show there's something I find humanity deceiving itself a great deal about this precession. I'm going to throw a ball, and we tend to say anybody can throw a straight ball, takes a great expert to throw a curve. But the fact is I'm going to throw a ball, and I wind up, and I let go of the ball here, but my arms and momentum, so I go on like that. I may spin it a little, my fingers will leave it. But I tend to be, the fact that I can turn my head sideways, looking not in front of me, but this way, makes me say I'm going to throw it to you, and I point at you, and I sort of, you say I've thrown a straight ball, okay? But the fact is I literally let it go up here. All right, that's not too clear, so I'm not going to play tennis. I want to get the ball to you, so I throw the ball here. And I hit it up there, but then it goes over there, right?
Yes.
If I wanted to go over there, I'd got to operate at 90 degrees, I'll tell you that.
Yes.
This is a precessional effect. I find humanity really, a lot of kids who don't know how to play tennis might try to push it 180 degrees like that with a tennis bat. It's not a very good way to do it.
Yes.
Okay? Right. I'm going to precess. I'm going to have a 90 degree effect in here. I'm going to turn this one at 90 degrees. So I'm going to turn it like that. And you can see, if I do that, I want to bring them together. They're obviously not going to fit. So we bring them together that way. Now, the reason this is not obvious to humanity is that you've all been brought up perpendicular and parallel. I'm going to have less applause. We got to get somewhere. Thank you. the world has been, the universe is operating radiantly, divergently, gravitationally, convergently, not parallel. And this is fundamental of convergence and divergence. So automatically, 2 is going to go to 3, or 3 is going to go to 2, not 2 to 2. The universe is not doing that kind of matching at all. Now this is the way atoms pack. This is what's called closest packing of atoms.
Yes.
Anyway, this we now have a very familiar form, the tetrahedron. And I find the little child, I want Werner to try to be a little child the rest of this afternoon. And a little child really has a feeling of how to get things into a corner. If you want to get an answer, you get convergence, you use convergence, you get a funnel, get things down into the corner. So this is what this kind of thinking does. And we're going to do quite a little of it from this point on. Jamie, let me have some balls. I'm just me, and for the moment, I can sort of the simplest me, I sometimes get a little fatter. The simplest me is just a sphere. And I'm just me, there's nothing else in the universe. Because if I wanted one word to describe the experience, life, my word is awareness. And I say no otherness, no awareness. So there's nothing to be aware of, so I don't know I'm in the universe. Maybe I'm not in the universe. I'm just not. That's one. But suddenly, I become aware of an otherness. Jamie, you be otherness for a minute. And we learned earlier today about mass attraction of bodies at great distance. So we get mass attracted and we're moving around in our orbits and wow! Now we got together like this and we can't go any further as far as you can go. But you can keep on rolling around on one another all kinds of different ways. So here then I'm awareness. Life has begun. But there is also suddenly another single Jamie. Right, I got 2 others somewhere that have a space hitherto, but this otherness comes in here and it can roll around and then suddenly gets in here. And now it makes a triangle. And before they were able to roll in any kind of way, but now they can't roll any kind of way because if you have 2 gears, they will go clockwise and counterclockwise, no trouble. If you have 3 gears, one is going clockwise, another clockwise, the third one doesn't know which way to go, it blocks them. So they can no longer rotate in the plane of the triangle. They made a triangle.
Yes.
But they can do this on each other. There's little axes, each one touches the other twice. So they can involute at this side and involute at this side. Involuting the top and involuting the bottom. Now a sudden otherness in the universe and comes in and is mass attracted to these 3 and rolls around here a little, gets into here and then wham, goes into the nest in between the others. And suddenly it stops involuting, evolving. For the first time, they cannot be independent, they become one. And suddenly we find the same form, the tetrahedron we had before. Now, here's tetrahedron and I had put together those 10 balls of the tetrahedron. I just wanted to feel this thing. This is something converging and diverging. It was the convergence we had, we'd just been experimenting with. And then the first time, they stabilized one another, and they seemed to be some kind of a stable system,
yes.
A minimum system. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is to show you that they could have come together, 2 rolling together over here, and 2 rolling together over here, and then those 2 groups could have come together. So this fact that we were able to be, because if there is an otherness, it has its awareness. So this myself and my awareness and so forth, and we come together, and then we precess. There you are. Beautiful precessional coming together. So our friend Ted Lee in that way.
Are two of them a system? Are just 2
a
system?
You have 2 or nothing.
Unity
is plural and at minimum 2. And the minimum kind of a 2-ness, even though I look like one sphere, is I have a concave and convex.
Yes.
And they're different.
Okay.
2 is always there. Unit is plural and minimum two.
And is two enough for a system? Can you call this a system?
Well, it's a very complex system because it's a sphere. Now we come back to the old geometry and the Greek definition of a sphere. And the Greeks defined a sphere as a surface equidistant in all directions from a point.
Right.
Now this meant then it could not have any holes in it, because as you came to the radius, the edge of the hole, the radius would change, right?
Yes.
So as defined, no holes, and as defined, it divided the whole universe, all the universe outside the sphere, all the universe inside the sphere, no contact between the two, because absolutely no holes. Now physics has discovered no continuums. Physics finds then that you would have to have a number of holes and say there are no continuums. The nearest definition in the terms of sphere and experience, nearest definition of a spherical, I call it a spheric experience.
Yes.
In physics is an aggregate of events approximately equidistant in approximately all directions from one approximate event.
Yes.
It's the nearest you could get, and you have to have time to do the measuring, and unquestionably you're getting out of gear with all the motion of the universe. So it'd just be a very approximate kind of sphere. That's all you'll ever have. But it'll always consist of a plurality of separate events, all right?
So then the Greek definition's impossible according to physics.
Of course, because we have the great second law of thermodynamics, that every system is always losing energy. And if it had no holes in it, there'd be no energy taken on or lost. That sphere is defined, you could throw away the rest of the universe, could be adequate to itself. It'd be perpetual, it's the first perpetual motion machine. So we find that
physics
does not...
Right.
Because it is a plurality of events, approximately to distance, and nature always does things most economically. Therefore, the events would be related by chords and not by arcs.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Everybody got that, you think?
But one, can you? Oh, you got it.
I have a lot of these events here, and they're always going to be related most economically to all the nearest events. So they would not use here's a chord and here's an arc. They would not use the arc, they would use the chord. That's most economical. So they would be corded together. And each one of these dots would then be connected to all the nearest ones around it. And you find all that happens is they turn into a geodesic sphere.
Yes.
It's omni-triangulated, because you can't get a lesser area than the triangle between them. So that you would get a... the simplest, what we might call then, the simplest sphere. What is the simplest sphere? One that has the least number of those points equidistant from a common radius.
Yes.
A common point, right?
Yes.
That would be the simplest sphere. This is a very complex sphere, really a great many little crystals. You find very rough here, but actually they're all interconnected in these most economical relationships. Whether it's the dust motes on our Earth or the atoms on our Earth interconnected by their little cords.
Yes.
Now, we find that the sums of the angles around a vertex of chords is different from around 360 degrees around if they were arcs.
Say it again, Bucky.
Because a chord is nearer to the center of the center of this chord is nearer the center of the sphere than are its ends, right?
Yes.
So its ends are emerging. So as different chords come together inside, they are emerging. But they will always be around them a sum of angles less than they would if they came together as a flat here.
Got it.
The mathematicians said that for an infinitesimal moment, that Greek sphere was congruent with the plane to which it was tangent. In other words, they assumed 180 degrees around every point on the sphere. And we find that's one of the things that's not so, which is one of the things we're going on to develop here, which will show up a great deal in mathematics. Anyway. What I want to get at is present time then is that the sphere has then something to do with certain great many events equidistant from a central action. So the simplest one we would have, we'd have an insideness out, having a center, and have how many points could you have that had insideness and outsiders?
Uh-huh.
That comes to be the next thing you have. You
yes.
find that 2 points do not have insideness and outsiders.
Right.
They have. Then we have 3 points. They don't have, it said to define a plane, but we've now discovered you can't have a plane of no dimension.
Yes, but it looks like, Bucky...
When I get 4 points, for the first time, I have insiders and outsiders.
Yes. We've been taught, however, and often think that 3 points gives us in. We've been taught and often think that 3 points makes inside and outside.
So we said a plane, you kid yourself, you could have a plane of no thickness.
Yes, exactly. So it really takes 4 points.
I'm saying you can't have a plane unless you have thickness.
Yes.
Now, one of the games that mathematicians play topologically is assuming surfaces that don't have any other side, things like that, really games that cannot be experimentally demonstrated. And nothing to matter with mathematicians playing games. Games are games. but when it comes to the physicists employing a game where you can't have experimental evidence, I say he's no longer a physicist.
Yes. So it takes 4 points to have inside and outside.
That's right.
With 3 points, you perhaps have the concept of inside outside, but you don't have the experience
It has betweenness, but no insiders, outsiders.
Between, but not inside and outside.
Right.
So 4 points is the minimum number of points.
The word inside has to be inside of a side.
Yes, fine, I got it.
Right.
So the inside of a side. Yes.
We come really to a minimum. Let's have the game of the necklace, Jamie. I'm going to be a little child now playing a game. My mother has a necklace. She's a great big woman, so the necklace is quite large. And I like it very much, and I can put it over the chair. I can put it all around. It bends and drapes over all kinds of things. It's wonderful. But I want to know, I keep playing with it, and I find that this is not changing its length. The sticks are not changing. Nor are they bending.
Yes.
It's only between them they're bending. These angles where everything goes on. So whatever is making it flexible is to do with these things. So I want to get rid of these sticks, but they're not doing anything about giving my necklace. I want to know why it does what it does. So I'm going to get rid of everything. So the child begins to reduce things that way.
Yes.
And you find they're continually tearing things apart, throwing away parts, and trying to find out what is really worthwhile. So, I'm now down to my necklace getting a little smaller, but still very flexible. I need Jamie maybe stand near me because these things are misbehaving a little. So here's my necklace, and I'm going to take out another, maybe take out two this time. It's getting a bit sort of slow. So I'm down to 4 of them. And it's a necklace that has a V in front and a V down my back. And folds up like that. Incidentally, this is what the teacher told me about the square, you remember? The only reason I did that is because the blackboard held it in shape. And she never recognized the blackboard, remember?
Yes.
Now, anyway, this is like this, so I'm going to take out one more. Leave down that. So I'm down to 3. And for the first time, it doesn't drape. It's holding a shape. It holds a shape! I guess it holds a shape. Boy, I can get my head through it and everything. It has a hole in it, and it holds a shape. Then I discovered I can't have a polygon of less than 3 sides. So suddenly, no longer, I can't put my head through it anymore.
Yes.
So this is the minimum polygon. A little child has found minimum polygon. The last case of polygon is the only one that holds its shape.
Uh-huh.
So, you got a cube there, Jamie?
Yeah.
I I'm going to hold on to this because I like it so much. When I went to school, they taught me then everything was made out of cubes. Eh? Teach architecture that, so forth. This is mine, this one I want. Now I want to have something that I can get inside. Children love to get inside and outside of things. Go back in the womb, get inside the bed and outside. So I want to have a minimum something I can get inside and outside.
Yes.
Now I'm a child and I got two triangles here. I like my triangles so much, I got two of them. And I find that there's two triangles. I'm going to put this one together with that one. I got to break it open at some point. So I'm going to be very consistent. I call this male and this is female. An angle is female, this is male. Male to female. I'm going to have male to female, male, female. I'd have another male to female. Another male, another female. I put two triangles together. I got four triangles. Boy, is it great. I can get inside of it. Wonderful?
Yes. So that's four out of two.
So this is synergy.
Yes.
What was actually right there? There was an angle and they're complementing one another.
What do you mean by complement, Bucky?
Well, I opened it up.
Yes.
And it really rather open. It needed stabilizing. So these it didn't stabilize one another.
Got it.
And right now, here is the minimum inside and outside, 4 points.
Minimum solid?
Minimum system.
Minimum system.
No solids about it at all.
Okay.
Minimum system is a minimum something.
Okay, I got it, yes.
Minimum something.
Yes, yes.
And something I can point to, and it has insideness and outsideness, and it consists entirely of triangles. So it's a minimum system in the universe, and only a triangle holds its shape.
And only...
And I want to have a word, I want to define structure.
Yes.
And I found that engineering has no definition of structure, nor does physics. By structure, I mean a complex of events which interact with one another to produce a stable pattern.
Okay.
I have three independent edges and three independent flexible corners. And they interact with one another. May I have the triangle back, Jamie? They are interacting in 66 parts, interacting with one another to produce a stable pattern.
So that's a structure.
Yeah. This is structure. Triangle is structure. Structure is triangle. Now, how and why does it do what it does? Remember the principle of leverage.
Yes.
Okay. Every pair of scissors is a pair of two levers with a common fulcrum. And the longer the handles, the more powerful the shears, right? So what we have here is this is a tension fulcrum, as Galileo showed you could use.
That's a tension fulcrum?
Fulcrum.
Yes.
And this is a pair of levers.
Yes.
Because if I open this up here, then I can take the two and they simply go like that.
Yes,
The third side, then, is a push-pull member, which with minimum effort, by taking hold of the ends of the levers, stabilizes the opposite angle.
Yes.
Each one of these stabilizes the opposite angle with minimum effort. Nature does always say minimum effort.
Bucky, once more, what... Between the two levers, what is this member called?
I call it a push-pull member.
Push-pull member, fine.
Because all structures have both push and pull. And
these are tension fulcrums?
That's a tension fulcrum, right?
Got it.
So now, we see these six parts interacting to produce this stable pattern.
That's minimum structure.
Right. So this is a minimum system and consists of four minimum structures. Therefore, it's a minimum structural system in the universe. Boy, that ought to be something pretty important.
Yes, sir.
Wow.
Bucky, it should be.
I just want Jimmy.
It should be something pretty important because of the universal rule about nature works with the greatest economy.
Yeah.
So if you reduce, if you've come to the minimum structure and the minimum system, you're now talking about the way nature works. That's what would make it something pretty important, yes?
So important that it is all there is. Anything that we can point to. Yeah. Now she'll have the...
I wanted to share an experience, a realization I had about triangles, because I don't think people really get it, that everything that is out here in physical reality that has shape and exists in time exists by the fact of its triangle.
That's right. Anything you say, I recognize that. The recognition is because there's some pattern stability. And you can't have any pattern stability except by virtue of triangles. So anything you say, I recognize as pattern, it goes back to triangle. Now, I'd like, next thing, Jamie, would be, you know, maybe have slides. This is a picture you recognize right away of the landing on the moon. But in the foreground are some rocks. I want you to look at those rocks very carefully, and you'll find that you can't have a rock of less than three faces around a corner.
Yes.
You can't have a rock of less than three faces around a corner. May I have another picture? Next one is going to be of Mars.
That is Mars.
Oh, this is the Mars. Both Mars and Moon, you can look at all the rocks, and there's never a rock of less than three faces around a corner. Quite a lot of them are that way. And they will then, very far, not only then can they have to have three faces around a corner, but every face, a minimum face, would have to have three edges.
Yes.
So you can't get a something anywhere in the universe of less than tetrahedron.
Got it.
This is the minimum something of the universe. The minimum point toability.
Yes.
And it always has inside and outside. So in the minute we get to the minimum something, we don't start off with that there's something called four, one, anyone. There's four vertexes, there's four faces, there's six edges.
So this has four vertexes,
yep.
Four corners.
Yeah, those are convergences, four corners.
Right. Four faces.
So the corners are really the tuned in.
Yes.
And the faces are the tuned out.
Got it. Yes.
Those are the outness and the innerness.
Yes. And the
there's six relationships. Okay? Now, I said the minimum something in the universe has six, and I spoke about earlier today, with every turn to play, you get six moves.
Yes.
This is to do with that right here. Now, later on we get into topology and you discover how very clear that is. Now, that's enough about the there's no more, Jamie, out of the...
That was it.
I just want to... Let me find it very exciting. I've gotten the NASA to give me lots of the best pictures. You get these lovely pictures of them. And you go around looking at... You try to break up rocks yourself. Take a hammer. Keep breaking it up. And you can't get down to less than three faces around the corner. So that... We get down and break it into sand. That's just the way it's going to be. Get down to the crystals. Always going to come out that way. At the minimum something, this is the minimum something. Okay. Now, here we are, experimental scientists, and we want to know how to really operate. And so from now on, we're going to pursue this subject. Next, Jamie comes on this.
The cheese tetra.
Okay. I'm going to take all the platonic solids, where you had identical lengths, edges, identical faces, and so forth, where you have the cube is most outstanding in the old platonic game. But the tetrahedron is in there, and there's the octahedron with eight triangular faces, and the icosahedron with 20 triangular faces. You have the dodecahedron with 12 pentagons, and we have also, not quite so symmetrical, what's called the rhombic dodecahedron with 12 diamonds. Now, I'm going to take all those platonic solids and make them out of cheese.
What's a platonic solid again? Once more, Bucky, a platonic solid is defined as?
The cube he starts off with. He has tetrahedron, octahedron, and dodecahedron. Those are the, and the icosahedron.
And what's the rule for a platonic solid?
All the edges and all the faces are the same. They're identical all the way over.
Got it.
All symmetrical.
Fine.
Now, I'm going to take those and make them out of firm cheese. I can take the firm cheese cube and slice parallel to one of its faces.
Yes.
What is left over is no longer a cube.
No.
Right, I take the octahedron and slice parallel to one of its faces. What's left over is no longer, there's a hexagon, that face, a triangle, so it's no longer symmetrical, right?
Yes.
I take then the dodecahedron with the slice, no longer the same. With one exception, we take the cheese tetrahedron.
Yes.
A slice parallel to one of his faces comes out a regular tetrahedron. For a very simple reason, let's take a triangle. You take a square or any other polygon, is a square, and if I slice parallel to one of the edges here, what's left over is no longer, right?
Yes.
But if I take a triangle, it doesn't make, if I slice parallel, it's the same triangle.
Oh, what's, I got it, yes, I see.
A triangle, you cannot violate the triangle. It's the only polygon you can't violate.
So what's left after the slice is still...
I found then I sliced parallel to the tetrahedron's face here, and what's left over is a regular tetrahedron.
Got it. And so a regular tetrahedron.
Yeah.
Yes.
Every edge is exactly the same length. So now I slice parallel to another face. It gets a little smaller, same, absolutely regular tetrahedron. Try all four faces. You find only the tetrahedron can accommodate asymmetrical operations in our universe without losing the integrity of its symmetry.
Got it.
Now, whereas the cube has only three planes, two parallel to one another, so it's three-dimensional.
Yes.
The tetrahedron has four planes.
Yes.
Absolutely unique. This is four-dimensionality, and the other is three-dimensional.
Yes.
So this is what we're dealing in here is nature's not only a minimum structural system in the universe, but a capability to accommodate asymmetrical operations in our universe, all the divergences, anything we know, all the abnormalities can be accommodated without losing the coordinate symmetry.
Yes, now what was the relationship between what you just said and the statement before that, that the cube had three
planes, three sets parallel to one another?
Yes.
It has three sets of perpendiculars and three planes. That's what you call three dimensions.
Yes. This is also three dimensions, no?
No, it is four planes of symmetry.
Got it.
And we deal in these perpendiculars, they're absolutely unique, and we deal in 60-degree coordination and not 90-degree coordination.
Yes. And so these planes are 60 degrees to each other?
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay. Well, I can have a perpendicular to one of the face planes, if you can see that.
Yes.
So, but anyway, it turns out to be utterly four-dimensional. So I gave you earlier about gears.
Yes.
And two gears could reciprocate. Four gears can, positive, negative. Three gears cannot, five cannot. When you deal in three-dimensionality, you have a static non-accommodation of an all-motion universe. And when you deal in the four-dimensionality, it accommodates all the intertransformers which we're going to run into very seriously here.
Bucky, are you saying from that, does it follow from that when you try to reduce the universe down to three dimensions, what you essentially do is to stop it or fix it artificially?
You can't get it down to, you can't demonstrate it to me.
That's right, not experimentally. But conceptually, we talk about three dimensions. Mm-hmm. And what I'm asking you is that the flaw in the, is the flaw in the notion of three dimensions that you make the universe static, which it never is experiential.
Oh, yeah. That is certainly one of its flaws.
Yes.
One of its non-agreement with experience.
Yes, okay.
And so when I'm using this thing, the XYZ coordinates, a centimeter gram second, where you have a cube of water, a given temperature as your basic measurement, say, what shape was that thing? And if you want to make this hold its shape, it has six faces.
Yes.
And you take the six, and you put a diagonal in each one of those, and it triangulates it, right?
Yes.
And pick up that tetrahedron, Jamie, and put it in there. Or you do it, Werner. make the diagonal correspond with each of the faces. There's one across the top. Look, you hold that on that corner, Werner. Down to that corner. It is only the tetrahedron that makes the cube hold its shape. When the six diagonals of the six faces then give you, when it holds its shape, because it always has a tetrahedron in it holding it.
Yes.
You can see that? I wonder if anybody can see that form. We hold it up above our heads a little. So you can see the diagonal of each of the square faces, what holds its shape. Okay? Now, next thing we're going to come to. I'm going to,
Bucky.
Yeah.
I want to be clear that you're really saying that part of, I want to be clear that you're really saying that part of the stupidity that we have about the world is the notion of three dimensions.
Right.
It's not, and the stupidity that, what goes along with that is the idea that the cube is the building block of the universe,
right,
and the square it's lower order, when in fact the triangle is the building block, mm-hmm, and the tetrahedron,
yeah,
so the triangle is the lower order, and the tetrahedron is the building block.
So the engineers have to keep putting in all these triangles to all the architects square buildings together. Now, I want to, Jamie, it's going to be necessary for me to say a little now for a minute or two.
Okay.
I gave you synergy, and therefore I want to really always work from the whole to the particular.
Yes.
And whereas the Greeks did have that game of the straight edge and scribe and dividers, but forget about the surface they're scribing on. I want to be not guilty of such a thing. I want to then, I've gotten to with you down to a minimum something in the universe.
Yes.
And a minimum something has to be tetrahedron.
Yes.
There is. So what you used to talk about as a point.
Yes.
Was very, very innocent. I don't like that word stupid we were using a few minutes ago. That human beings were very earnest and really did try very hard to get some logic and then proof. There was no question about that.
Yes.
But they didn't know the Earth was so big. They didn't know we were on a planet. they really did think we were on a plane going to infinity.
Yes.
Right. And the cubical blocks did seem to hold together. You pile them up, you don't see anything go wrong about it. The fact is that our Earth is such a big sphere that if I took two city block areas, I'm going to build a building on each one of those city blocks. And I'm going to build each one of them in relation to a plumb bob in the middle of each of the blocks. So the plumb bob will be a block apart,
yes,
in the middle. So you start making them very carefully. They all start absolutely together. Not until you get to 100 stories high, you get to where there's an inch between the two.
Uh-huh.
Not until you get to the height of Mount Fuji, you get a foot between the two. In other words, it's right easy that how the Greek world could have felt how satisfactory that cube was. I don't want to make them seem to be stupid at all.
Yes.
However, now we've really got to get on. You and I are pretty tiny. We really want to get on this big universe. We had to play the game the way the universe is playing.
Yes.
That's what we're trying to find out here. So I'm going to also, we were also taught then about the cube. We had multiplication by addition. We kept making more. And we find one of the things that quantum mechanics developed recently is because physics came to discover that the universe is energy, and the physical universe is energy, radiant as matter, convergent as matter, and divergent as radiation, convertible one in the other. But always, apparently, no energy being lost, so there's just so much energy. And we find then that nature then, with a given amount of energy, could do a few great big things infrequently, or a whole lot of little things very frequently.
Right.
Right?
Yes.
So that we have multiplication only by division.
Yes.
And that is really the essence of quantum. Now, I would like to carry on, do some quantation. We've got to the minimum something in the universe, which is the tetrahedron.
Yes.
I want to do something that you and I can do really, very reliably. I'd like to, can I halve the tetrahedron? If I can halve it and then halve it and halve it, and see if we can find out some other of the forms that we're familiar with, the other symmetries, like the octahedron and so forth.
Yes.
So that's what we're going to do now. We have here a tetrahedron. I want to cut it in two. Jamie, will you take your knife and just cut it, literally cut it in two? How do you cut it in two? You remember, I could spin it on its mid-edge. The tetrahedron, one of them in my hands. I can spin it like this. These six edges, the mid-edges, and then get an equator of the spin. So they just cut it on the equator of the spin. But you take it apart, James, and hold the two parts up. There are the two parts. They correspond to what you've been just seeing here. Now you can see the two square halves. Now will you, I'd like to take each one of those halves and cut each one of those in two again.
Bucky, are those two these two?
Just the same thing, sir.
These two are exactly the same. Yeah. Okay, fine.
The reason that this did what it did here is that where, remember I got three coming to two, they're coming together 60 degree angles and not 90.
Yes.
And where they actually come together, the touching point is a square.
Yes, got it. Okay. And it's obvious that these are the two halves.
These are the two halves right there, right. So now here, will you cut those in half again, Jamie? We had a green equator, a white equator, and a blue equator. And they cut it on the white equator first. Now, let me see then, the four, you got four parts now. You can call these icicles. I want everybody to see them. Might put them out really where they're good and clear, out on the brown carpet. But side by side, I want everybody to see they're just the same halves. Each one of those now is a quarter of a tetrahedron. Now we cut those in two again. The way you do it, notice you've got two equilateral triangles on the base. You've got a form here that has yellow base and red base. Same altitude, same base. You're going to cut these apart in those two. One's going to be an asymmetrical tetrahedron and a symmetrical tetrahedron. They have the same base and same altitude, so the volumes are the same.
I see.
So we cut them in two again.
Now the volume of the two pieces Jamie has are both the same. Yeah. Each has an equal in volume.
They both have the same equilateral triangular base.
Yes.
They have exactly the same altitude, so the volumes are the same. But one is symmetrical and the other is asymmetrical.
You get that? Same base?
Yes.
So this is now 1/8 of an octahedron, because I cut it once and two halves and the quarters. Now this is 1/8 and this is 1/8.
Yes.
And I'd like to have the four little tetrahedra together, side by side, put them the same attitude, right. Same attitude, okay. Then we've got four of these. You know, everybody can see those are the same. So these are, each one of those is 1/8 of the octahedron, of the original tetrahedron. Now I'm going to take the four 1/8 asymmetrical, which have a 90 degreeness, you can see. We bring these together. Jamie, would you pick up the other two there? Turn that. Each one of those is like the Egyptian pyramid. It's a half an octahedron. This is an octahedron. Eight equilateral triangular faces.
Yes.
And it consists of four 1/8 tetrahedra. So it amounts to really one half of the original big tetrahedron.
Yes. So a half tetrahedra is...
So those four there are the other half.
Yes.
Now, let's put that sort of quickly together. Put the four tetrahedra, one on top, one on each of the corners here, one down there. So I just want to see, that's another way which we could have halved it. We could have bisected the edges and removed the four corners, and you would then, because you had, when you double the dimension, linear is 2, the volume is 8.
Yes.
So I take away four little tetrahedra from the big tetrahedron. Let's do that. Take away the reds, drop them off, and you have then, this is then equal to four little tetrahedra.
Yes.
Okay. So the octahedron now, when the little when you're talking the little tetrahedron, it is about four times the volume of that. But it's only one half of the original tetrahedron. And we begin to, that business of dividing the edges is very important. Now I'd like to have each one of these. This is now then 1/8 of an octahedron.
Yes.
You see that has 90 degree corners at the center, because the octahedron has four symmetry of four corners, four triangles around each corner, okay?
Yes.
X, Y, Z coordinates go between its corners.
Yes.
Right. I'm going to take now, I need your help, boys, bending over is bad. May I have four of these? 4 1/8 octahedra. And Jamie, you stand up, hold up one tetrahedron.
I want to tape it.
I want to tape, you see this equilateral triangular face, which
yes.
used to be on the octahedron, which we know matched the tetrahedron on the corners, remember?
Yes.
So I'm going to know this will fit onto here, won't it?
Yes, I remember.
We put one of these on each of the faces. Can everybody see what we're doing all right? We're taking the tetrahedron and putting a 1/8 octahedron on each corner, because these equilateral triangular faces match. What does that give us? This here's our friend, the cube. Now,
that's beautiful.
What we had is a tetrahedron. If we call the little tetrahedron 1, the octahedron has a volume of 4.
Yes.
And 1/8 octahedron would be 1/8 of 4, which is 1/2. Each one of those is a half.
Yes.
If I took 4 times a half, which is 2, I added to 1 tetrahedron, which is 1. So the tetrahedron, the octahedron, the cube's volume is 3.
Yes.
When tetrahedron is 1, cube is 3, octahedron is 4. All these platonic solids, when you started with a cube, came out irrational numbers except the cube. And now when you're using tetrahedron as unity, all coming out rational.
Yes. So go over the...
Now, Bucky, Jamie, we'd like to cut up the tetrahedron some more.
Bucky, go over that last point one more time. Go over the point
right.
about the number of the cube.
You all remember, let's pick these up again. Take 4 of these together. I want to see the Egyptian pyramid. You all recognize the Egyptian pyramid here? I got it.
Bucky, let them see it on that side too, if you will.
Okay. You all see that, all right? And I used the other half and it made the octahedron, remember that?
Yes.
So that's where the 8 faces are. We had then that we had this octahedron plus 4 tetrahedra on its corners. Remember those? Put a couple up down here, Jamie. One on top here. Remember that? And so it was going on to make the regular tetrahedron. Remember that? Here's a great half tetrahedron right here. Remember it? Remember this half of a tetrahedron?
Yeah, turn to that direction.
That's one of these, huh?
Can you all see that half tetrahedron split that way to the square center?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I had the octahedron then had, this is 1/8 octahedron. The octahedron, when we had a tetrahedron in the center, we had an octahedron with plus 4 tetrahedra in each of its corners, making the big tetrahedron.
Yes.
And the big tetrahedron is a volume of 8, and we took away 4 corners, 4 from 8, left you 4. The octahedron is 4.
Yes.
1/8 of an octahedron is then 1/2. So each one of these units here is a half. Half of a regular tetrahedron.
Yes.
So then I took 4 of those. Let's take another tetrahedron here. And I'm going to, because you see the faces match. The equilateral triangular faces match. And we know this is 90 degrees here because it is cut to the center of x, y, z coordinates.
Yes.
So I put 4 1/8 octahedron on the 4 faces of the... I match the equilateral triangle faces to the equilateral triangle faces. There we are, there's another cube. We've got two cubes. Anyway, make it clear again, we added 4 1/8 octahedra. Octahedron had a volume of 4, so an eighth octahedron is 2, and 4 times 2, 4 times 1/2 is 2.
Yes.
I added a volume of 2 to a tetrahedron's volume of 1, making it a volume of 3.
And so the cube then comes out a volume of 3.
3, right.
Whereas the tetrahedron is your initial right. volume, right. so a volume of
right.
1.
Right. Now when
do we get the 4, Bucky?
This. Hmm?
Where are the other volumes?
The octahedron is volume of 4.
Fine. That's it. That's what I wanted. Thank you.
Now, you remember, nature is always most economical.
Yes.
Right? So if you're accounting universe in cubes, you're taking up 3 times as much space as you would in a tetrahedron.
Yes, I got it.
And nature couldn't afford to do that. And she would not be very inclined to use that kind of a cube anyway, which had no strength. Inasmuch as we find then that the tetrahedron is the minimum structural system in the universe and it is the minimum way of accounting volumetrically.
Yes, yeah, so one more thing, Bucky. If you start out with the cube as the volume of 1, what does it bring the tetrahedron out to?
All irrational numbers.
All the other shapes become irrational.
Yeah.
So then I just want to make sure that we've been clear about that. When you start out with a tetrahedron, all the other shapes then are rational.
They'll come out rational.
Very good.
Now,
I
did all that through halving. I want to do another form of halving.
Yes.
They're coming out with another model here.
Why don't we keep the model back here so everybody can see it?
Right.
I think that'll be good.
I got it, Bucky.
Now, there's another way in which you can have a tetrahedron. You have all the perpendicular bisectors of each of the triangular faces, and if I were to cut down this face with a knife and right along this edge here, can you see that?
Yes.
I can cleave it down like that, or I could cleave it this way, cut it into 2 halves, right?
Yes.
So that's what we're going to do now.
Great.
But notice that every one of the faces has, because it's a triangle, has 3 perpendicular bisectors.
Oh, wait a minute. Every one of the faces. Yes, I got it, Bucky.
Because it has 3, it's dividing each of those triangular faces into 6.
Yes.
This introduces the prime number 3.
So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Right. So inadvertently, while I'm deliberately halving, I'm also introducing 30.
Because of 4.
Because I'm dealing in a triangular symmetry.
Yes, got it.
The triangle itself introduces the 3-ness. So.
Yes, got it.
Jamie, are you cutting them all apart now?
Yeah,
let's go. Got it 2 halves there, fine. Now, I would like you, James, those are 2 halves. There's another way you can halve this again by cutting here, James.
But Raj had a system here.
Right.
So what is the rule for halving this,
Bucky? Yeah, that's right, Raj.
What's the rule for having this shape? Does this shape have a particular name?
You can see those are 2 halves, can't you? Let me show these. See this right perpendicular thing here? These 2 are halves. Can you see them right?
Yes.
What we did, how do you do it? I just put this in a chopping block like this. It has symmetry side over, so you simply take the mid edge here, perpendicular edge, cut down like that.
Great.
All right. Now, Raj, go ahead with the next act.
Next acts.
Line them up. That's it. Line that one up. Right. I want you to see, everybody, that you now cut the tetrahedron into 4 parts. And each one is what we call a quarter of a tetrahedron. And this is the center of gravity of the big tetrahedron we started with. And now, I'm going to take, you have a big octahedron for me. This is going to make what we call the rhombic dodecahedron. You add eight of these quarter tetrahedra to the eight faces of the octahedron.
Say it again, Bucky, one more
take
time.
Eight
of these
quarter tetrahedra.
Quarter tetrahedra.
That's a volume of two, eight times a quarter.
Got it.
And add that two to the eight faces of the octahedron.
Yes.
And you'll find it can come together with the 12 diamond faces, what we call the rhombic dodecahedron.
Yes.
Whose volume is six.
So that you have some sense of what my sense is, that Bucky's showing us, is the relationships between the relationships between the relationships. And what you can get out of this, even if you can't follow each particular step, is that you can get that there's a relationship from a relationship from a relationship. And remember, it all started out with Bucky's tetrahedron. That's all he's done here, is tetrahedron.
But the point is, I have this is multiplication by division.
Yes.
I'm cutting up unity, and I'm cutting it in symmetrical manner. I was only allowed to halve, and in doing my halving, I've inadvertently come into 24ths of a tetrahedron and eighths of a tetrahedron and so forth.
So now eighths we're going to 4/8,
right,
which is 2, plus
Two sets of those now, Jamie, yeah.
See, we've taken two tetrahedrons here and cut them again into fourths, which is the same as this.
We've got too much around. People can move that tetrahedron down, move everything away that's irrelevant. Here is then, cut those apart. Those are each one quarter tetrahedron. I want them cut apart. So I want to see 8 one quarter tetrahedron. Okay? Sure that we can count them up, that there are 8 there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8. Now they have an equilateral triangular base. The octahedron has an equilateral triangular face. We're going to put one of these on each one of the faces here. Pick them up one by one. Don't get in the way of people seeing. Be sure, Jamie, lower it. Wait, pick it up and let everybody see it come down, that it matches neatly. All right. Now we tape it in place. That's it.
Called Fuller's sandcastle, isn't it, Bucky?
The sandcastle watch out and doesn't watch out.
All right.
Not watch out.
Non-washable out Fuller sandcastle.
You mustn't get too childish on me.
All right.
Here is what we call the rhombic dodecahedron. Notice the beautiful thing that these on this come. They come together and make a beautiful plane inadvertently.
Yes.
You got 12 diamond faces. That's why the dodeca is a rhombic dodeca, because those diamonds are called a rhombus. So, the rhombic dodecahedron, and we've added 8 one-quarter tetrahedra, which is a volume of 2,
right,
to a volume, an octahedron with a volume of 4, so its volume is 6. Here we have another of those beautiful symmetrical forms of nature, and it is in the same rational value with the tetrahedron.
Yes.
Now this happens to be a very particularly important kind of a form. I mean, I have these close-packed spheres of the... Here they are, Jane. When spheres close-packed around one another, you can get six around one, like that hexagon. Get 3 in the top, 3 in the bottom, you can get 12 around one. A nucleus of spheres is 12 around one.
Is that 12 around one, Bucky?
No, there's actually is no nuclear ball in here. The nearest is in the middle of a face.
Got it. Okay.
If I put another layer on it, it would be a nucleus, and you'd find it has 12 close packed around it. And this nuclear sphere with 12 close packed around it, then there's spaces between the spheres and close packing. And those spaces are also symmetrical.
Yes.
They're constant to each sphere. Each sphere has its own domain of space.
So you're talking about the space in here.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. There's all the space in between them. So when they come together, where there are 12 points of tangency around each sphere, 12 points.
Yes.
And those 12 points of tangency are the mid-faces of these diamonds.
The 12 points of tangency are the mid-faces.
Right, right in the middle there. Right. Put your finger. That's where the sphere comes.
I see.
A sphere inside of here. Now, if you take rhombi-dodecahedra.
I got it.
And put them together, they fill all space the way cubes do.
Yes.
Each one is a domain of a sphere.
Yes.
We have a most beautiful condition here now. What we're discovering is that when the tetrahedron's volume is 1, and the cube is 3, and the octahedron is 4, and the rhombi-dodecahedron is 6, which is the domain of a sphere, the sphere itself volume is exactly 5.
Uh-huh.
1, all the prime numbers, 3, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yes.
Your 4 across it is even with 1, 2, 3, 5. The first 4 prime numbers. All nuclear, all everything to do with nuclear, basic packing, all coming out, beautiful whole rational number.
Yes.
And you have to say to yourself, listen, it's just me and the universe. Which one am I going to take? The square that doesn't hold its shape or the triangle that does hold its shape? Am I going to pay attention when I learn that nature is always most economical? She would have to account in the terms of the tetrahedron, but not in terms of the cube. So can you do accounting? Let's see what you can do. Remember how, again, you were taught with squares that 2 times 2 is 1, 2, 3, 4, you said. And he said, 3 times 3 is 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And that seemed to be very sad. So when you have n second power, you've always said squaring. I noticed you were saying squaring. Okay? All the scientists say squaring. X squared, you say. However, let's get to this. So 2 times 2 is 1, 2, 3, 4. And so 3 times 3 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So you say 4 times 4 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So you say, filing says squaring. And every square is a 2 triangles. Nature's most economical. And she's going to do it within here. What's she going to do in here? She won't, you take the 2. So, now can you tetrahedron? So the next thing we're going to show is a tetrahedron. Do this out in the brightest place we can get right here. Let me have the top one first, Jamie, Raj. Here's one tetrahedron. And I'm going to call edge module then, this edge module.
You're going to call it what?
This is edge module.
Yes.
And if I get to many of them, I could call frequency of subdivision into how many edge modules.
Yes.
With frequency. But for instance, if I put this on top of here, it now is 2 frequency.
Got it.
But it isn't a frequency when it's 1. There's no frequency about 1. This is what we call primitive. Here is quite clearly tetrahedron volume of 1. And I'm going to put it out on the carpet there. Then, I've got here 1, 2, 3 tetrahedra and 1 octahedron.
Yes.
And the tetrahedron is 1, isn't it? So 1, 2, 3 in tetrahedra and 1 octahedron is 4.
Now the octahedron is the 2 pyramids, one on top of the other. Yes, Bucky?
The volume is 7. Volume is 7.
4 plus 6,
put
7,
it on
yes.
The wall.
So this is the octahedron. And this has a volume of 4, Bucky, yes?
That's right. I have one tetrahedron over there, and then the next one layer has 3 tetrahedra plus 1 octahedron.
Bucky, are there, if this is a volume of 4, are there 4 tetrahedra in here? Is this
There are 8 asymmetrical tetrahedra.
Okay.
But remember, I have this.
8, 1/8.
I'm getting complementary forms. They're not all the same. I'm not dividing tetrahedron into all symmetrical tetrahedron.
Okay, that's right. I remember.
I'm getting all the different geometries and finding out how they're related to the appearance of that A module. And there's something else we'll come to, which we call the B module, which will show up a little bit here.
All right.
We have then, in that first model there, there's a volume of 1. The second model there has a volume of 7. Now the next one has... Here I have one tetrahedron in the corner. Look at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tetrahedra. Can you see them all right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tetrahedra.
Okay, just let me do like this if I can. This is the first one here. This is the second one here. Third one. Fourth one.
Fifth one. And sixth one.
Okay, right. Got it.
Now I've got, however, also, here's an octahedron. You see it?
That's the octahedron is here.
Another octahedron here.
Octahedron here.
And another one octahedron.
And one in here. Okay.
So I've got
three.
I've got 6 tetrahedra plus 3 octahedra.
Right.
And 6 tetrahedra plus 6 equal number 6. And plus 3 times 4, I've got 12.
12.
I got, there's an upside down tetrahedra space here, do you see it?
Yes.
Between the octahedra.
Got it.
So I got one upside down. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tetra plus 1 going the other way, 7 tetrahedra. Plus 3 times 4 is 12. 12 is 7 is 19.
Yes.
The volume of this thing here is exactly 19.
You want that up on the board, Bucky?
Right, 19 there, yeah. Now, I've got one more there. I've got tetrahedron. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 tetrahedron. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, God bless you, 5, number my octahedra here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 octahedra.
Yes.
And also got upside down tetrahedron. Another upside down tetrahedron here.
Right.
And another one here. We've got 3 of those. So that amounts to, just make it a column. You got, remember, we had 10 tetrahedron.
Right.
And you have 3 upside down tetrahedra, 13. And you have 6 times 4 is 24. Not 24. Add that up. The volume of that thing is 37. Okay, I'm now going to add this one to this one. I add 1 to 7, and the volume is 8, right?
Yes.
So put 1 plus 7 equals 8. Now I'm going to add 8 to 19. What's 8 and 19 equal?
27.
8 plus 19.
27.
I'll put it down. 8. So I take the 27 and add it to here. I got 27 and 37. How much is that?
64.
Write it down. Now, 8 is 2 to the third power. Write 2 to the third power. And 27 is 3 to the third power. And 64 is 4 to the third power. So what we had then, the volume of his one is 2 to the third power is 8. Volume of this one is 2 to the third power, which is 27. And volume of this one is 4 to the third power, which is 64. And so we can say tetrahedroning,
yes,
in correspondence with third power instead of cubing.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes. Very clear. Thank you. Beautiful.
And since it's incredibly structural, and this is exactly the way the spheres are closely packing, this is a model of spheres and closely packing. This is the way the atoms pack. There they are.
The most economical way to pack spheres would be
that way?
Well, as we get into the actual penetration into the atoms where they're packed, this is where they're packed.
Got it.
They are closely packed, and so this way nature is doing her agglomerating. And if you do the tetrahedron structuring and do things the way nature is doing in a structural manner, structural system, you're coming out of this beautiful rational whole number and doing it three times as more economical than the XYZ coordinate system, centimeter gram second system.
Yes, got it.
So which is, I mean, you're at school now, you're a scientist.
Yes.
Which one is nature using?
That one.
You bet. Which one are you going to use from now on?
That one.
What are you all going to use? Yeah.
Bucky, the thing that I... Let me tell you what is beautiful about that for me is that it boggles what I've been stuck in. It's boggling. And because it boggles what I'm stuck in, it lets me get unstuck from it. So I can't get that from society. I can't get that from the rule book. I got to get that from my own experience. So what you've done really is to return me to my own experience in relation to my understanding of how the world is put together. I want to thank you for that.
Now this is what Bridgman meant. This is operational mathematics. This is experiential mathematics. It's experimental evidence all the way through. Now, I'd like to go on a little more, Jamie. I've been giving you some volumes.
Yes.
We have something really quite beautiful, which is the 12 spheres close packed around one. I spoke about tetrahedron them and the cheese business. I'm going to introduce something to really also getting the most primitive of life itself, like the word awareness and having to have the otherness. An angle is an angle and conceivable due to the convergence of lines.
An angle is an angle.
And it's conceivable due to the convergence of two events.
Got it.
Again, our friend two again.
Yes.
And an angle is an angle completely independent of the length of its edges.
Yes.
Make a triangle out of three angles, and the triangle is a triangle independent of the size.
Of its
triangle
edges.
Is a triangle and conceptual, independent of size. And a tetrahedron is a tetrahedron and conceptual, independent of size.
Yes.
And this octahedron is conceptual independent of size. And may I have the icosahedron, Jamie? This is a structural system. Remember, a system, then, I said, had to be triangulated.
Yes.
System is triangulated. Whereas I can have, it has to divide the universe into insideness and outsideness. I cannot have a system of less than three planes around a corner. This is the minimum system in the universe. And it's structural because they're all triangular. I can also have four triangles around each corner. Therefore, it's structural, all triangular, and has insideness and outside. So it's also a structural system, the octahedron. I can get five triangles around each corner, all triangulated, therefore structural, dividing the universe inside and out, therefore a system. It is then also a structural system. I cannot have six equilateral triangles around a corner. They'd add up to 360 degrees, go to our teacher's infinity.
Uh-huh. Okay.
There are only three structural systems in the universe. Tetrahedron, octahedron, icosahedron.
Icosahedron.
Icosahedron, 20 faces.
20, okay, yes.
And now I would like to go into thinking about, because these are what I call primitive. They're conceptual, independent of size. Now, size is measured, takes time to measure size. So size in physics is time.
Yes.
Right. And time we have all, it comes from cycles.
Yes.
And a cycle is a minimum, an all-wave phenomenon in terms of a cycle.
Now, wait a minute. Cycle. A cycle is an all-wave phenomena.
Unity is a circle.
Okay.
Yourself. An angle is a fraction of a circle.
Yes.
So an angle is sub-size or sub-time.
Yes.
So primitives of sub-time and independent is time.
Yes.
This is nearest, now we can really understand the word abstraction means dealing with the primitive, but conceptual. Abstractions are mathematics try to have abstractions, non-conceptual.
Yes.
Our experiential mathematics, our primitives are conceptual.
Yes.
Independent before, a priori to time. Now I'd like to...
So you're saying then that the abstraction can be represented conceptually, yes? Is that accurate, Bucky, what I just said?
Yeah, I said, I don't have to use the word abstraction.
Fine, okay.
Because I have something really that they tried to get to with the word abstraction, but they meant independent of time and size.
Yes. Okay, got it. So the primitive...
It's called an integrity, a conceptual integrity.
Yes.
Independent of size.
Got it.
Now, coming then to our friend tetrahedron, and I spoke about the cheese thing, the same way you'll understand that I could push in on one face of a tetrahedron, if it's a cheese, compressing it, and it simply gets smaller but symmetrical.
Yes.
If I pushed in on one face at a given rate and pulled out on another face at the same rate,
right,
it would stay not only symmetrical but the same size.
Yes.
So I have a couple. One is importing, the other is exporting at a given rate, and it doesn't change its shape, it doesn't change its size, but it would mean the center of gravity moved to the game in this way. So it's moved like the center of gravity.
Yes,
but
yes.
It had to change in a plane. But if I push in on the third face at a new rate, and pull out on the fourth face at the same rate I'm pushing on the third face, but this is another pair, not the same rate I'm pushing in and pulling out in the first pair. But it remains then the same regular tetrahedron. I find it can entertain two completely disparate rates of change in the universe without losing any of its integrity of symmetry, but what it means is that its center of gravity will now move in a helix.
Aha. Uh-huh.
So the
Now that's, let me understand that. So the center of gravity moves in a helix.
Yeah.
When you push on one plane, pull on another, that's one pair.
I moved in an arc, but when I do it this way, it moves in a helix.
Got it.
Okay. So I find that the consequence of entertaining disparate rates of change and taking care of all without losing its symmetry is it brings about motion. Very interesting thing.
Yes.
Right. Now I'm going to introduce size. I'm going to push in on a face of a tetrahedron. I'm going to push one face of a tetrahedron towards its opposite vertex.
Yes.
As I do so, the lines get smaller at an arithmetical rate.
Yes.
The areas get smaller at a second power rate.
Right.
And the volume at a third power rate. Three completely disparate rates.
Yes.
So it's getting smaller. Now finally, I've moved this face. But when I was doing that, it never lost its four corners. It's four faces, it's symmetry, it's six edges.
Got it.
These were independent of size. Okay?
Yep.
So the rates of change of the size, but the rest of the characters not bothered at all. Now I deliberately bring this face congruent with the opposite vertex. Now it comes to common, no volume at all,
yes,
no length at all, and no area at all.
Yes.
But there's still the four faces, those are not varying. There were four planes, and there are four vertexes, and so those are all there. I have now a tetrahedron of no volume at all, with all the planes going through the same common center.
Yes.
So can I make a model of a zero volume tetrahedron?
I'm sure you
can. Yeah.
Yes, I know you can.
So we take four eight circles for four planes.
Yes, uh-huh, I got it.
Raj, you want to help us here?
Let's see, Werner and I
could
probably do it.
Now, I want you, Werner, to, here's that great circle plane, to bring those opposite corners here together like that. From here, You see, four great circles reestablish themselves. There they are, and they're all going through the same center.
So that's a tetrahedron?
These are the four planes of the tetrahedron, all going through the same common center at the same time. This is the empty tetrahedron, no volume tetrahedron. It's a nuclear tetrahedron.
Yes.
So we have the nuclear structural system. It's a very extraordinary kind of matter. And these are, then, the 12 vertexes here. These 12 vertexes, six around the equator, three in the North Pole, South Pole, three in the North Pole. Those are the 12 points of contact with the 12 spheres in closest backing.
Yes.
The center of each one of these would be the center of the 12 spheres, close packed around the sphere at the center.
And Bucky, was it related to the sphere that fit inside
That what we call the rhombi-dodecahedron?
Yes, was it related?
Would be then perpendicular to this point here.
Yes,
tangent to that point there. Right. Okay. So now this gives us what we call the vector equilibrium. It's called the vector equilibrium for a very simple reason. Remember, I spoke about nature is convergent, radiantly divergent, and gravitationally convergent.
Yes.
And we find that the universe is eternally regenerative, no energy loss. So that these two are some kind of extraordinary balance where we find, I'd like to think, and I gave you six vectors or edges for every minimum system in the universe.
Yes.
So I'm going to want you to think about a tripod, camera tripod. And we have these three vectors spreading their legs like this. As they do, they only have one end of each fastened to the other at the top.
Yes.
Their centers of gravity are coming apart, therefore as they go apart, remember mass attraction decreases as they get further apart from one another. So they would tend to accelerate apart. So you then take three more and make a triangle. Now we have, each one has two ends, both ends of each vector are fastened to the next one. So it's a closed system. The tripod was an open system.
Yes, I see.
The tripod was radiant and trying to disintegrate in the universe, but the same three arranged end to end as a closed system are more effectively stable, and they keep the other three from coming apart.
Yes.
This is the way, really, gravity is always more effectively arranged vectors of the universe than are the radiations.
Yes.
So that the gravity conserves and the integrity of eternally regenerative universe and the better arrangement of the patterning of the gravity in respect to the radiation or the divergence. So now I want to look at a hexagon. I have then, you know, six spheres close packed around. Get that hexagon, but these six radii are exactly the same length as the six chords. But the six radii are explosive, they're trying to come apart. They only fasten one end of the center together. But the outer ones are fastened both ends, therefore this is what we call equilibrium, and with the gravity more effective and guaranteeing the integrity of the universe. But what we have here are then four planes and four hexagons. Look at each one of those planes, cuts the other in such a way as to break it into hexagons.
Yes.
You see that right?
Yes.
And everybody really feel that there. So that this is then not just in a plane explosive, but this is omnidirectional, four-dimensional explosion.
Yes.
With the chords more effectively arranged than the radii, therefore containing them. So this is a model of the gravity of the universe overcoming the tendency of the universe to disintegrate. This is what we call syntropy is more effective than the entropy. The entropy is the exporting the energies, and the syntropy is the importing the energies. So this is then, vector equilibrium is an omnidirectional phenomenon. But we find that nature never stops at equilibrium. When you're flying, call it coming to a stall. A stall is a point when you're in equilibrium.
Yes.
And anything can happen. And then something does happen, but it's going to be asymmetric. This is, nature refuses to stay at the center of symmetry ever. So this is the form through which nature moves. So we have then, when we have spheres in closest packing, it makes then, if we have lines running from the centers of spheres to next spheres through the points of tangency, we get what we call
through the points of?
Through the points of tangency of the spheres.
Got it.
We get a set of lines or vectors, which we call the isotropic vector matrix. That is, all the vectors are the same length. Everywhere, the angles and the lengths are the same. I mean, isotropic vector matrix. And that is then nature's basic frame for any given frequency in a tuning phenomenon, for instance. And you set up this tuning and it'll be activated anywhere in the universe quite independently. But it is always then a great complex of vector equilibria.
Yes. Okay. This represents a vector equilibrium in exactly the way you just said.
Right. So it not only is the zero volume tetrahedron, but it's also the vector equilibrium. And it is the nucleus. Cubes have no inherent nucleus because they're not convergent, they're parallel.
Yes.
It's only in convergent system you have inherent nuclei. A universe with
yes,
nuclei.
Yes, I see. Bringing the surfaces together,
This is the nucleus. And you have an inbound and outbound, and the nucleus sphere is always a volume of two, but because it's both inbound and outbound.
Yes.
Very fascinating. I'll just give you quickly that. If I have then closest packing of spheres, I get, because the vector equilibrium has 12 vertexes, there are 12 spheres close packed around one. We have then the next layer, there's always 42. We have another layer of spheres, the way I keep piling them up there, and maybe 92. Next layer is 162. And next layer, 252. They always end in the number 2.
Yes.
Because they do, I can take off the suffix 2, so say plus 2. I can do this and have a plus 2 out here.
Right.
And then I'll have 10, 40, 90, 160, 250. Each one of those is divisible by 10, so I get 1, 4, 9, 16, 25. That's a progression of 1 is the second power of 1. Your 4 is the second power of 2. 9 is the second power of 3. 16 is the second power of 4, and so forth it goes. So this means then the number of balls in the outer layer is always what you call frequency to the second power. Frequency to the second power times 10 plus the number 2.
Yes.
This is very interesting. When the human beings got into their genetics and then finally got down to the tobacco mosaic virus, got into virology, where they found the DNA, RNA, inside the protein shells of the viruses, we found that the X-ray diffraction showed that the protein shells were always geodesic domes. And the man who were doing that first study in London University wrote me and told me they found that the nodes in the showing X-ray diffraction seemed to be corresponding with my geodesic domes. So I sent them the numbers of the nodes would always be frequency second power times 10 plus 2. And when they came to first great international virology meeting in Cold Spring Harbor a few years ago, about 10 years ago, they published the front page of the New York papers. This was the formula which we'd found. Now, when nature wants to get into the protein, the virus is the most difficult of all things for us to deal in, and their shell is this protein shell of dealing in this baby here. Because I had 6 vectors in the tetrahedron.
Yes. So
one unit of quantum, this is one unit of quantum, it has 6 vectors. This has 12, so there are 2 units of quantum, and this has 30 edges, which is divided by 6 is 5. There are 5 units of quantum. There are 2 units of quantum here and 1 of this. This one gives me, I get one volume for 1 unit of quantum, I get 2 volumes for 1 unit of quantum, and here I get 4 units of volume for 1 quantum. I get the most volume with the least structural investment. That's why I use this as the base for all the geodesic structures. I found this is what nature is using for the protein shells of all the viruses. But these numbers get to be even more fascinating the more you look at them, because you get to the, let's take a look at it again, 12, 42, 92. 12, 42, 92. This gets you then where you have a, there's one nucleus. There's no nucleus yet showing up, because we get a nucleus, then you get, because remember you can nest balls. I have a ball, then I have 3 balls. I nest it. There's no ball between them.
Right.
I get another layer. There's no ball at the center yet.
Yes.
But I could nest from here. He goes, no, no, yes. No, no, yes. So you start with a nucleus and then no, no. You get 2 layers and no possible nucleus. But at this layer here, you begin to get a nucleus in the center of his face, but not as yet included. It's not a nucleus until there's 2 layers around it.
Yes.
So this has been the really primitive condition within the domain of one nucleus in the universe. Get here with the number 92 is 246, 146. That's the number of neutrons in uranium, which is chemical element number 92.
Yes.
This is number 92 layer here. We add the 92 of the value of the outside, because the outside is always a value of 2. We get uranium 238. Just wanted to see, get a little feeling of the how intimate we are here in what I've been giving you today. I don't want you to feel it's remote from the from the world of the physics or the chemistry, whatever it may be. I'm absolutely confident today that I really have not misled you about this. If you get at your Synergetics book, there are now 870 pages. And we finish volume 2, which is another 800. The experimental evidence now is just overwhelming. And I don't expect physics, which I said has physics, we have there was a book written by C.P. Snow, Two Worlds.
Yes.
The Humanist and the Scientist. And the book was a very great seller. And he said the chasm between the humanist and the scientist was continually increasing, would never be spanned. And he said the occasion because at the outset, the humanists, as the writers and the poets and artists, took just an aversion to the smell of chemical laboratories, and they just didn't like the feel of it at all. And they couldn't really see what's going on in their mathematics anyway, so. I met C.P. Snow, and I said I was very moved by his book, but I felt that the beginnings of the chasm were occasioned otherwise. We go back to the early man discovering a lever, and all anybody began to know is levers. They began to use them as oars. And they used them many, many ways. And they found they could put a capstan on the front deck of the ship, put many of the levers in it, and many people could get on them. You accumulate your power to pull up a great rock anchor in the early Greek ships, whatever it may be. And then we learned if you could take that wheel with all those levers and turn it up like it's under water, waterfall, and you could understand a water landing and how it could build up its power. Man felt and understood his technology very well. Then he could understand that we got that to a steam turbine, all right. But came the middle of the 19th century, and we came to electromagnetics. And there suddenly was an electric generator, and they were generating power and went over to move a motor a great distance. And the humanist said to the scientists, we want you to tell us how those levers work. We want to know what's pushing what here in order to get this power through this solid wire over there. This is going to affect all humanity in a very big way, and we as the writers must then explain to our fellow humanists what it's all about. And the scientists said, we're awfully sorry, but there's nothing to see. They said, what does go on here that is that we have a coil, make an electric magnet, and we can then move a needle. And the needle can give us some quantitative results if we have one more winding around the coil, or whatever it may be, change the cross-section. All the Ohm's laws and so forth pertaining to found rates of change which were very reliable, so they could really make predictions about changing apparatus and be quite reliable. So I said, we're able to handle this mathematically, but there's no model to look at. We're terribly sorry about it. Anyway, this was a parting of company. Then, keeping at their measurements of energy, the physicists came to black body radiation. And with black body radiation, they found something very extraordinary. They found that the black body radiation was manifesting a fourth power rate of change. That is, n to the fourth power. They said, this is four-dimensional. Superscript 2 is two-dimensional, superscript 3 is three-dimensional, superscript 4 is four-dimensional.
Right.
And you can only you cannot find another perpendicular to the XYZ coordinate system that isn't parallel to one of the planes already established. Therefore, inasmuch as nature is using four dimensions, you can't make a model of it. Therefore, we are completely justified in saying there's no model. And so they felt that now this is where they came to the idea they really were an abstraction. And that they must then carry on with their numbers in a way, and they could learn by probability and calculus of curves and so forth, matrix calculus. They make all kinds of predictions and gradually get some agreement with what the experiment evidence is showing. But they were, since the middle of the 19th century, science has been what it called flying on instruments, not looking out the windows anymore. There's nothing to see. And because they've gone on so well by learning all the tricks of games and mathematics and getting some agreement, they obviously are going to hold on because there's nothing they can see. They don't dare let us know what you let go of. Now, I just want to realize what a real perplexity they are in. I don't see this as any conspiracy in the power of science to be obscure or anything like that. They get caught. They get caught for what seemed to be obvious long ago. It is no longer obvious. That's where the word axiomatic came from. but I did say to C.P. Snow, he is a scientist, and I took him through what I gave you this afternoon. And he said, I can see. There was that New Year's after I'd seen him, which is, say, 6 or 7 years ago. Somebody asked him some questions. They often do, big people, for a weekend and rear ends, he'd have some statement. He said that he was quite now convinced that the chasm could be spanned. That he said an American architect had shown him something, convinced it could be done. He forgot my name by then, but that was not the point. The point. I simply wanted to point out to that that how it happens that now the computer makes it easy for science to be even more awkward. So
yes.
I do not expect the academy to say, okay, I have had some very great scientists go over what I go on with you and said, I can't find any fault with anything you've said. My intuitions say you are right, but I don't have enough of the coursing data between the different arts, between the chemistries and the physics and so forth, to be able to identify this yet.
Yes.
But it does seem reasonable. We have really come to a great many identities, and the two books do make that clear. But if we're going to get there, it's going to be because I spoke to you about earlier today, the humanity everybody's in now. It's everybody's era. And by virtue of the synergetics, everybody can understand what's really going on. If you just keep at it, it will only be a few more months before we'll have all the connection between the physics and the chemistry, and so it's going to be bound. But don't expect the academy to tell you this is the way it's going to go. You have to, as human beings, go as I did today. Which way are you going to play it? Are you going on experiment evidence, or are you going to go on really, you understand the dilemma, how we got there? But the point is, we do now have the option. That's it.
Beautiful. Thank you, Bucky. Bucky mentioned the book Synergetics, and the material which Bucky went over here, and really a great deal more material, is in the book Synergetics.